Live.
Okay. Hello all, and welcome to our second Brave Sound podcast. This is a special episode because we have with us a very special guest and friend of both Austin and I. This is Greg DeAngelis. Welcome, Greg.
Hi, thanks for having me.
So, before we introduce Greg, I'd like to say one thing about this show. This is the show where we uncover the stories, processes, and worldviews behind some of New York's most creative and artful musicians. So, Greg. Greg is, in 2018, he graduated from Rutgers University with a degree in music. He is now currently enrolled at the Manhattan School of Music, receiving his master's for music performance. He has, to this day, over 40 original music that is published, and he has taken a band around New York City's finest venues. And he is a great peer. We all go to MSM, and the first time I met you, Greg, you were a guest in Matt Holman's arranging and comp class. So I remember he had you come into the room to just give a demonstration on the trombone.
Right.
Yeah, and I remember you brought in like five different mutes, and I was like, I didn't know who you were at the time, but I was like, oh damn, like this guy, like he has his shit together. He's professional, you know? And I and
fooled you.
Matt Holman.
No.
What a guy.
Yeah.
Matt's my guy, absolutely.
Yeah, well, he's very professional as well. But yeah, that was my first experience. And I thought you were a classical musician. I don't know if you remember the conversation we had.
No, I don't, actually. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we were just... blanking. Yeah, I was just asking you because I didn't see you before, but then that was because you just came to the school because it was your first year. But, yeah. Just wanted to give you that intro. But I think the reason I thought that just was because you like came in with a certain like professionalism that's like, I mean, jazz people, they have it in a different way, you know?
No, I definitely take it as a compliment. I know a lot of classical musicians who hold themselves really, really well. So to be compared to that is really cool.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. So you're from Long Island?
Yep. Farmingdale.
Farmingdale, Long Island. So what is your experience like growing up? You're a jazz musician now.
Mm-hmm.
You grew up on the island. What was your experience like growing up on this island?
I had a lot of really, really positive musical experiences on Long Island. I think Long Island has a really, really, really great community of educators, and the music here, it's filtering in from Manhattan. So I think it's, you know, the musicians are second to none.
And your dad's an educator too, right?
My dad's is a band teacher and a trumpet player, and we did a rehearsal with him together. Yeah, so
you played in the band.
Hey Pop, what's up?
So for those of you who don't know, we will be featuring Greg and his latest music and his latest project. It is called the Qtet.
The Double Qtet, yeah.
The Double Qtet. It has, what is it, five brass players, four rhythm section players.
Yeah, so the whole idea is it's a brass quintet plus, so not a trombone quartet, because that would be four trombones, but trombone plus rhythm section, and then add in a brass quintet on top of that. So I guess six horns, three rhythm sections. It's total a nonet, but really it's kind of like two separate entities just kind of coming together. It was it was fun.
Two ensemble mashup. Right?
Yeah, definitely.
And I saw you had you have French horn and tuba. And then two trumpets, two trombones, or?
Yeah, so the brass quintet is made up, it's like a traditional brass quintet is two trumpets, French horn, trombone, and tuba. And then, so that's the brass quintet. And then myself on trombone as well. And then drums, bass, piano.
Mm. Is that standard brass quintet instrumentation? Two bones, two trumpets, French horn, and tuba?
Well, tuba, trombone, French horn, and two trumpets.
Oh, okay, so you have double the bone.
Double the bone, which is my preference.
Right.
I'm biased.
Yeah.
But it's cool.
Yeah, well, I'm very fortunate to have the opportunity to play in the ensemble. And yeah, when we rehearsed, I was just super impressed by everything. You know, just the music quality, super good compositions, you know, grooving. And it just, also just playing with that many people, you know, I haven't done that for such a long time, and that force of having brass, you know, that wall of brass behind you.
I thought it would be cool to have that rehearsal, because at that, so we had it in late September, right? It was like September 26th we did the rehearsal.
Yeah, yeah.
And I figured everyone who I asked would be super, super hyped to do it, just because it's been so long since anyone has really played with anyone. So we had people come from New Jersey to Long Island just because they were, you know, I offered it to them and they were like, absolutely, I want to play some music. And so I think we got, you know, obviously the level of musicianship was like super, super high. Everyone who was there was like ready to play and hungry to play. And it was just a super positive experience.
It was, yeah.
It's kind of a beautiful thing when everybody's just so down, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's, well, anyway, let me switch the camera. I was reading this article by Derek Sivers, and he was saying that he was asked to do a concert at Berklee College of Music, I believe. It was a university. He was asked to do a concert.
Okay.
And it was like a 2-hour thing, and he requested $1,500 for his band. And whoever was hiring him was like, oh, that's kind of steep, a little out of my budget. Maybe can you do 1 hour? Like, what would be your rate for 1 hour? And Derek quoted like $2,000 or $2,500 for the 1 hour. And she was like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, well, he's like, of course it makes sense. I'll play for free. You know, like if you're gonna hire me and I only get to be there for an hour, like, it's kind of a drag for me to get all my stuff together, all my bandmates, and then come and only get to play for an hour.
Sure, sure.
You know, if we get to hang and play for 2 hours, then yeah, it'll be $1,500.
So when would it become free? If it's like 3 weeks?
If the audience comes to his house.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Just watch me play in my house.
If you pay my rent for a month, it'll be free.
Right, right. But I think the idea is that, we're paying. When you pay musicians off, I mean, it's not totally true, but I like the idea of you're paying them for, like, getting on the plane to get there, and then music is the craft. And it's self-evident when you see, like, all these brass players and everybody so freely coming to do this gig, or this rehearsal that's, like,
Definitely.
Out in Long Island
and
stuff.
And I think it's, a special, not that obviously COVID is a nightmare for the music industry especially, but I think it was, like, a special, you know, part of COVID that everyone had everything shut down for so long, and then out of nowhere it was like, hey, here's this idea. I would imagine a lot of people who are involved with a brass quintet, classical brass quintet, aren't often playing with a rhythm section with improvisation around, so that's a cool opportunity, and just everyone's kind of getting a little something out of it, on top of the fact that no one's played with another human being in 6 months, let alone,
yeah.
You know,
mm-hmm. Everyone's... That thing is, you're combining the worlds too, like French horn, like unless I'm playing in like a musical theater pit, yeah. I would never play like in a band with a French horn or tuba, except when you're doing like brass band stuff, which I guess this kind of is, but it's a little more of a jazz influence as well.
Yeah, it's definitely a lot of different influence. I think we've definitely got some R&B gospel influence. A lot of different musics are finding their way into this.
Mm.
Which is jazz anyway, is at
it's
this
a
point,
lot of...
it's a conglomerate of everything that's going on, that's everything that's been for the last now over 100 years, if you want to get deep with it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think a lot of different influence, a lot of different people are, so like a tuba, I think one of the interesting things about, definitely about working with French horn and tuba, mm-hmm. is trying to figure out how to work those into... now this type of sound, because it's, you know, with tuba, as far as like an arranging technique or a compositional technique, you are really starting to clash with the bass. You're in that bass range. Bass
yeah.
is no longer kind of all by himself doing what he wants to do, but you still want the bass to have the freedom to walk and play whatever. Like, I just want to give the bass chord changes and give him the opportunity to do this
flexible.
Like a small group, but still have the tuba actually fit in there. So there was a lot of challenge with, okay, what kind of notes can I be giving the tuba right now in the chord that's going to make this work? I don't always want him to play, you know, in complete unison with the bass. I want there to be some in what interval can I make that? How can I make mm-hmm. this work? And the same thing with French horn is the French horn covers a ridiculous range. It goes from, you know, the middle of the trombone range up to the middle of the trumpet range. So it's really like bridging a gap between trombone and trumpet with this really kind of diffuse sound.
What do you mean by diffuse?
Diffuse, it's a really spread sound. Very rich, definitely, yeah. And the bell is facing backwards, so when you hear it,
attack, right? It's more of a...
Exactly. When you hear it, I would definitely compare a French horn more to like a flugelhorn.
Oh, more rounded sound.
Yeah, mellower.
Yeah. Huh.
But even more, I think the word I keep thinking of is diffuse, but the even more mellow than that, because it's actually facing in the other direction.
Yeah.
So you're getting the sound back from
the wall.
Yeah, or whatever. If they're even facing a wall.
Yeah. That is a crazy concept. I always wondered why it does that, and I kind of just like let it be like, okay, this is the way it is. Like,
yeah, I have no idea, honestly.
But when you're playing outside, it's like, that's kind of a problem, too, because like there is no wall for it to jump back off of, you know? It's kind of just like, goodbye.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, that's an outdoor... That's another COVID challenge. We couldn't do this inside anywhere, so we did this in my backyard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
which we're doing again on Saturday. But...
Yes. Well, fortunately, the weather looks like it's nice right now. And I'm crossing my fingers, you know. But yeah, it should be good, and the weather's still good, temperature. So yeah, you can still do stuff like this.
Yep, definitely. This is probably the last of it before the weather turns.
Yeah.
Pretty bad.
Yeah. So now I want to play. You know, I've grown pretty familiar with your music, at least these like five compositions we're going to play on Saturday.
Sure.
And I want to play something for you. I don't know if you've heard it before, but I just want to hear your opinion on it, and, you know, because it reminded me of your music, and I want to see if it's an influence to you.
Used to be, yeah. And that book's not a game for free. Babylon sister.
bass clarinet. I'm experiencing this for the first time.
And on camera, too.
I know, right?
Excellent fade out. Is that you?
Yeah.
That was spectacular.
Thanks. Just thought.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, on that subject, I'd love to know what gave you the idea for this type of band, and who, or maybe you had specific inspirations, like, I want to do that, or, yeah.
Yeah, definitely, just like, it's almost, like, right to the point is this is trombonist Ryan Keberle, if you guys know Ryan.
Yeah.
Has a couple of records out of a double quartet.
You were telling me about this at the rehearsal.
Which was, like, the exact thing that I heard. It's just, with him in the band, it's two trombones, tuba, French horn, and trumpet. So he's got a brass quartet plus himself and rhythm section. And I heard that at Rutgers at some point, and I was like, holy shit.
Oh, they played live?
Like live records. I didn't see them live or anything, but I heard the which Marshall is on as well.
Yeah, yeah.
He's the other trombone player. And like I heard the sound and like with the French horn and the tuba in there and the way that he's such an amazing composer and arranger. I was like totally smitten with the sound, and I was just like, I gotta try to write something like this. And I did one for my senior recital.
Right.
And added another, rounded it out, made it a quintet plus a quartet. So it's almost exactly stolen.
Okay. We can talk about how artists steal later. I think that'd be a good discussion. But stay on here, like, is that band a lot of people from Maria's band or Maria Schneider's band?
Maria Schneider's band.
Because Marshall and Ryan.
Marshall and Ryan. Mike Rodriguez was playing trumpet, I believe, in that band. The tuba player, he doesn't play with the band. I don't really know who the rhythm section is, to be honest. So hard to say, but Ryan and Marshall, from Maria's band.
Quite a powerhouse duo.
Yeah, I mean, like, you hear Ryan with these, like, incredibly lyrical, like, he's such a melodic improviser. I think when I hear him, I'm just like, man, he's just like straight melodies. Everything he plays could be its own song. And then there's this one track on one of the records that is Our Love Is Here to Stay, and Marshall just absolutely destroys it. Like
yeah. Do you want to play it?
Sure. Or, yeah.
Can you pull that up?
Yeah, it's pretty wicked.
Yeah. I'd like to hear this. The thing that gave Greg some direction, like that's pretty badass, you know, just like to have your influence so clear, you know.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, definitely. And that whole band is killer improvisers. Tuba player improvisers,
even the tuba player,
French horn, everyone's taking solos.
Yeah, I'm curious who's in the rhythm section as well. What's the name of the record?
Ryan Keberle Double Qtet.
Our Love Is Here to Stay, is that on the record?
It's one of the two records, so...
Oh. Heavy Dreaming?
Dreaming is the other one.
Yeah. Oh, Adam Birnbaum, Matt Brewer, and Brad Whitmer. You can keep it a little lower than that. Yeah, perfect. Contrast to Ryan's melody.
But this is Marshall Jones.
Yeah.
Definitely Marshall Jones.
So you would say Marshall's a bit more like a technically.
I don't wanna, you know, compare them because I think they're both incredibly lyrical and melodic.
Yeah.
Both are chops, like ridiculous.
But yeah. Different styles.
Definitely different styles.
Yeah.
Thank you. kind of sounds like valve bone a little bit.
Yeah, right?
In the upper register, at least.
Absolutely.
But a bit more... What's the word? Diffuse.
Diffuse.
A bit more diffuse.
Nice.
All right.
The
Brave Sound Vocabulary Podcast.
Yeah. Gaining vocabulary words with each interview.
Man. Yeah, I mean, that's... Especially, like, the bone and French horn together, like, that's a richness you don't often hear in jazz. You know, it kind of reminded me of orchestral playing, but with a bit more, because all the players have a bit more bite to their sound than I think they probably would in a, well, that's not always true in, like.
Maybe what you would traditionally think of as.
Yeah, maybe in, like, chorale, like. Orchestral thing, not like Mahler brass.
Sure, yeah. <that's...
laughs> you know.
But if that were to exist in a jazz context, I feel like it is in the context of like a chorale. So it would be more of like a well-rounded. Mm. So that's why this is a little bit more of an exception. But also the reason I think it was it's good to listen through the French horn solo for people that are like checking in that aren't as familiar with jazz. Is because French horn's a very unconventional instrument in the jazz context. Like, it's very... Like, that was, like, one of, like, the only French horn solos I've heard. Besides, like, a cadenza and, like, a classical piece or something. But, like, to actually improvise on the instrument is...
Sure,
I assume very difficult and, yeah, very, like... Also a tuba as well.
Right.
You know, a tuba player I know... He was trying to get into jazz tuba, so he was seeking out someone that is a jazz tubist. But that's also, like, a very, like, niche field. Like, there's only a couple of them in the city, you know.
There's one guy who has a record out. His name is Ray Draper. He has a record out on Blue Note, and it's two horns, him on tuba as the leader, and the other horn player is Trane.
Oh, wow.
And it's tuba, and there are some other Train records where Ray Draper, there's some like
I know Ray, yeah.
Outtakes and stuff, extended takes of Ray Draper taking like solos on Olio after Train. Or like
so whose record was it? Was it Train's or was it Ray's?
They're
studio outtakes, right?
From Train's record, yeah. Oh, and then okay, Ray Draper has that I know, I'm sure there's more. This is the one that I've seen is him. I forget the name of it. It's got a blue cover and it's him and Coltrane are the two horns.
Wow.
And I saw it and I was like, what the fuck?
I can look that up.
Yeah. Well, Train has some unique instruments at times, like definitely like live at the Vanguard, he was playing with a bass clarinet. Which is also a pretty unique instrument.
Well, if you look at Africa Brass, which is like one of the first ones that I started to get into as far as John Coltrane goes, Africa Brass has like an entire, maybe six or eight brass players behind Coltrane playing these. They play Greensleeves. They play his tune Africa.
Oh.
Freddie Hubbard's in the band, and I think Julian Priester's playing euphonium.
Oh,
stuff
really?
Stuff like that.
I didn't know he
like,
played euphonium.
Yeah, that's the only thing I've seen of him playing euphonium. But, like, yeah, like, Brass, Africa/Brass is the album name. Yeah. And it's just this whole, it's wicked.
Yeah.
Is Ray Draper, he's on a lot of Mingus records, I feel like.
I honestly do not know.
But, yeah, in any case, Mingus used a lot of low brass, like contrabass tuba, contrabass trombone, actually.
Sure.
On a lot of stuff, given like some real, and I think it's Ray Draper on a lot of those like Mingus records as well.
I know
totally Earl
McIntyre does it now.
Oh really?
He'll like play bass trombone, and also he has a tuba next to him, and he'll switch over and do that. It's so good.
That's a common pairing.
Yeah, definitely bass trombone and tuba.
Also in musical Peter Pitts, also that's considered like a double. Pretty standard double.
And if you can do sousaphone, that's always...
Well, you do sousaphone, trombone, and tuba.
Yeah, right. Sousaphone and tuba, interchangeable. It's just like a marching version of the tuba.
How did you get into sousaphone?
When I was in middle school, I started playing, I was a baritone player. Like,
that was
like,
your first
instrument I played was baritone. So I was comfortable with the vowels. And then I wanted to play more. I wanted to play jazz stuff. I, you know, my friend had gotten into jazz stuff. He got into like our All County Jazz Band, mm-hmm. Matt Malinowski, Matt.
Yeah, right. So
he got into All County, and I was like, I
want. Is that Nassau County?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
And I wanted to do it, so I went home and I was like, Dad, I want to do All County Jazz. I want to be in the jazz. And he was like, not on baritone, you're not. I mean, and he was like, you gotta learn trombone.
Ah, yeah.
And then in middle school, we needed a tuba player in like the school wind ensemble.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'll do it. And then I learned how to play tuba in like the eighth grade. And then I just bought a sousaphone in college.
Right.
And yeah. And I already had a feel for the vowels just because of
baritone playing.
Yeah. And it was, I was, you know, 10 years old or 9 years old when I started. So that's kind of ingrained in you when you're like a little kid.
Yeah. It's so out. It really works like that.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot
of things, you know.
And then you start to do like little parade. Like I started, I just like said it at different points in the day. I was like, hey, I own a sousaphone. And they were like, you're going to do parade gigs.
Right.
And so like every summer and spring. Holy and like, shit, man. I was, parade gigs. Oh yeah.
I feel like for gigs like that, like the requirement is you have a sousaphone.
Exactly.
Like, you don't even have to like play a sousaphone. You can just have it.
It's exactly why I bought one. Because I knew it was going to, like, pay itself off of it. Not only did I really want one, and I am a glutton for buying instruments. I think all musicians really just want to buy instruments. But after that, I was like, I know this will pay itself off eventually. It's a
business investment.
And Souza is named after...
The dude.
John Philip Sousa.
John Philip Sousa, yeah.
Are you into his music at all?
I've definitely played it before in, like, wind ensembles and stuff.
Of course, of course.
Yeah, so that... I've played... like a fair share, not like I'm not like an expert or anything, but I've definitely played a lot of Souza marches.
Sure.
Because I was in this band of Long Island's.
Bully, yeah.
Yeah, Bully. Were you in that?
I've done like little, just like, hey, we need a third drum player.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's like me too. Like I was never like in the band, you know, but I had the refrigerator white pants and the red the red vest and under the direction of what's his name?
I know Michael. Alex. Michael Flamhap.
Oh yeah, Michael Flamhap. Yeah, but yeah, he's super into Souza marches and
yeah.
That it's kind of like a. That's like pre World War One.
Yeah.
Think that they were written like night or like around that era.
Turn
like,
of the century.
Early, yeah, like some of them like late 1800s, early 1900s. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
I did not expect to be talking about Souza.
John Philip Souza. That's right.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Man. Well,
the man.
You know who I was?
The cat.
I was listening to Percy Grainger the other night.
Hell yeah.
I mean, I'm only bringing this up because I came from like a hardcore concert band wind ensemble background in Texas where that's like...
Word.
The thing, and when I came to New York, like most people I knew did not come from that, you know, they've been playing jazz for forever, you know, especially at Manhattan School of Music, everybody's been improvising since forever. So to hear you saying that, like, you started on baritone with the wind ensemble literature, that's really cool to me because, yeah, that's where I come from as well. And I think it's just one of the most underrated ensembles, and when I was in high school, I was like, I'm playing jazz. I don't want to deal with the wind ensemble stuff.
Yeah.
But now looking back and listening to, you know, the contemporary people like Frank Ticelli or John Mackey.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then like Percy Grainger, even Souza, like that stuff is like wind ensemble is like incredible.
Very serious. Percy Grainger is an incredible composer. Like that stuff is absolutely ridiculous. Stuff like. The one piece that I can think of right now, because I'm no expert on Percy Grainger, is like Country Gardens or something like that.
Country Gardens.
Like killer.
Yeah.
Killer stuff. And we had to do like at Rutgers, and I remember a conducting class, we had to conduct some like excerpts of Percy Grainger.
What major were you in Rutgers?
Jazz performance. They made everyone do...
Conducting?
Yeah, we had to do a full year of conducting.
Jesus.
Oh no, a semester of conducting.
And you did wind ensemble as well?
No, I never did any.
Okay.
They just made us conduct that stuff.
Have you heard of Vesuvius?
No.
Frank Ticelli?
Yeah, I've played that.
Oh, you've played that?
I've played that.
I've played that on marimba.
You have a concert background too, yeah.
Yeah, I guess we all do.
That's crazy.
Played that in the Manhattan School MSM summer camp when I was like really young.
Oh, so, word.
Yeah, I was a part of that. Yeah. But yeah, no, it is. There is a lot of really great repertoire for wind ensemble, I would say. Yeah, it's kind of weird because I feel like that is kind of a product of the education system or marching. I'm not sure. Maybe I'm wrong. But in my opinion, I feel like wind ensemble kind of is a product of the education system, the need to
have a ton of people.
I think it definitely gets participate. I think together. It definitely gets highlighted because the band, like when you think of a band teacher sitting in front of a band, you're not thinking of a jazz band. At least at Farmingdale,
no,
which was an amazing music program that I was super super lucky to go through.
Really?
Farmingdale was, you know, all our jazz program stuff was after school or before school, or it was just kind of like, you know, the wind ensemble is the band that you're in.
Yeah.
So I would say that it's definitely highlighted more. More people know about that stuff. Think about an orchestra more than they think about, you know, a jazz band in school. Unless you're, you know, in a program that really, really highlights jazz, or
like LaGuardia. Maybe,
LaGuardia.
Or
even schools like, I know East Meadow has like a great, great jazz program in there.
Long Island,
yeah.
Yeah.
We're talking Long Island now.
No. God, no.
Well, yeah. Also, Southern rehearsals are in East Meadow. I remember going to that school a lot, actually. But I was talking more about how it evolved from the orchestra. Because, like, originally you have an orchestra that was, like, a few hundred years old, you know?
Word.
And that, like, kind of became the thing. And then the wind ensemble...
It's an artificial thing created by the public... Well, it wasn't created by, but popularized by the educational system, because they needed more people to be able to participate. Like in a jazz... Even in a big band, you can only get 20 kids.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you have a school with... Well, in Texas, it's something like 100 or 200 people in the band program. I think that's kind of a Texas thing. You're not gonna put them all into five big bands, you know. You're just gonna have a couple wind ensembles.
Yeah, but what about the idea of a full orchestra? Because you all also have the string players. Like in my school, we had
a separate
string
thing, yeah.
Orchestra, and I always thought that was the norm. I was like, oh yeah, strings, brass, they don't go together, you know. But then I would go to like a youth orchestra, and I'd be like, oh shit, like they all play together, you know. And yeah, the strings are kind of like the glue that. And the brass are like the accents. They like add like different sounds and textures every once in a while, you know.
Right.
But yeah, I always thought it was weird why they don't play together.
Yeah, it is a thing.
Yeah.
It's just to consolidate teaching, I think, to have the string teachers just deal with string people. But we had full orchestra. But it was also a thing. They would rehearse like once a week or after schools or things like that. And that was like an extracurricular activity to the concert band and the
that is cool. That's cool. Your school.
You guys didn't have that?
No.
Oh man,
we had that for like we had a couple. We had to like that was like a pullout thing. Like
right.
The top couple players in the wind ensemble and like the top couple string players in the orchestra came together and we all did like a.
It's more exclusive because you know two trombone players or sometimes even one is like enough.
For yeah, like two or we had like two or three.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
Yeah, so it's hard to, you know, public school is all about mass participation.
That's a really good
point.
And
you want to get everyone, and then you don't want to turn anyone away from a music program. You want
to
get a chance.
We're just saying like that was the results. Like wind band was kind of like the redheaded stepchild behind orchestra. It wasn't like a, I mean there was literature written for it, and it was a thing, but it wasn't what it is now. Now there's like this whole modern. It's literally fueled by high school band.
Right. You can there's money to be made there for composers and arrangers and
right.
People in that field.
Man, we've been talking about concert band for a long time, but you did it through all through high school.
Yeah, I definitely like debated before I decided to like do the jazz degree. You know,
I
was like, yeah, maybe I'll do. I was on the fence, like, will I do the, you know, a classical performance degree or a jazz degree? Because I was definitely better, like, objectively better at playing classical repertoire, as I was a better trombonist than I was an improviser.
At the time, right?
Definitely.
Wow.
And I was like, I'm not all that good at improvising quite yet, or at least from my own perspective. I think everyone thinks that. But, like, I was like, I definitely am more familiar with the rep and, like, you know, this is where my experience is. All, like, all state and whatever bands that I did were on the wind ensemble side, not on the jazz side. Mm. So I was like super on the fence about that, but I was like, nah, forget it. I'll do the.
Yeah. So what about improvising and jazz music made you ditch this thing that you are already really good at? What made you say I want to do this even though it's not yet my strong suit?
Yeah, it was. I think I had just more fun with it. I think definitely was a better means of expression.
Mm.
Improvising was just, or maybe I liked the challenge. It's hard to even remember at this point, like why I was. All I remember is like playing swing, playing Count Basie stuff. Got me moving more. Like when I think of my favorite pieces that I've ever played, I think of a couple of wind ensemble pieces, but the top one that I think of is Hayburner, the Sam Unesco, Count Basie tune.
Oh, yeah.
Like, flute and trumpet playing a duet like that, I was like, shit, this is like, this will forever be my favorite thing. This is the most swinging thing I've ever heard. I want to play this. Like, the trombone riffs in there are ridiculous.
Yeah. Is that an experience you had at all state? Oh no, you did.
That was in all county. That was the first time I played. But then I, played Hayburner so many times that, because it's such a popular chart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is.
Still, definitely my favorite. But nothing in the, not that the wind ensemble music can't, but it, for me, nothing like moved me the way that did, or hearing a great solo, or even standing up to improvise and getting that chance of outward expression like that. As much as I enjoy playing trombone in the classical repertoire along with it, stuff about improvising and playing like swinging music and
I'm really curious because we all go to MSM, right? And jazz, right? Jazz conservatory. It's a big branch, about 100 kids. And I feel there's so many, everyone loves jazz there,
mm-hmm.
pretty much. And then there's like, everyone's into different types of jazz because there's so much to choose from. Like when people hear the word jazz, a lot of people could have like a negative connotation with it. Maybe they're like, oh, this is like too sophisticated for my ear or something. Like people tend to like have like one association with it, maybe because they're not familiar with the full broad spectrum of the term and how much there is to explore inside. Like, I'm really curious, what like part of the jazz genre really like could give you goosebumps, you feel, or really touched you? Is there a specific part to it, or is just the whole like encompassing term?
Yeah, like
that's the answer. Yeah,
definitely. Like, I think the answer is the way that Count Basie's band swings for me.
Woo.
Like, Count Basie is like, that's my favorite. Big, no disrespect to any other big band that's ever played, but like Count Basie for me will always be like the.
Wow.
Like the way that band swings, that's it for me. And then I think as I started to, we all learn stuff in these like institutionalized, in these places where yeah. things are kind of myopic and you're staying within yourself, you learn about theory and all the harmony and stuff that goes along with it. I definitely enjoyed the challenge of hearing more, complex things, but I think that's all secondary to, for everyone, it should be secondary to like, holy shit, this feels so good. Like, this feels good. That's, and it's not like the wind ensemble music didn't feel good. It felt great to play wind ensemble music, but like, something when you're playing or you're listening to Count Basie, or I think of Hayburner specifically, is like, that gets in my skin.
Can we listen to that?
Yeah.
I want to hear some.
Watch me move a little. I'm going to try not to dance because I can't.
You got it, man.
I can't.
Boo-doo-day
and that shit.
But knowing this about you, it just makes so much more sense that you're going through with the double Qtet and everything.
Sure.
You're really coming out of... On the Atomic Mr. Basie, right?
No. It's... Wait, is it? It's the blue cover.
Oh.
That's Basie straight ahead.
Oh, yeah. Word. Yeah.
When did you start listening to, like, this type of music? How old were you?
Probably like 11 or 12.
Wow.
When I was like first exposed to it. I don't think I went and found it on my own.
Yeah.
But someone was like, hey, go check this out. Or I heard you in a band. Or like...
Who told you, hey, go check it. Check this out.
My first private teacher, which was Jim Malinowski, my dad.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you were saying that earlier.
Yeah, so he was the guy who I went to.
Ah, okay.
Can I put on something as well?
Yeah.
Tad Dameron from the record, find the record The Magic Touch.
Oh.
Yeah, this is just like supremely swinging.
Have you seen it now?
No, On a Misty Night, can you find that?
Oh, yeah.
Wait, but before you put, I'll just... Yeah, pause it for a second.
Okay.
Yeah, so, man, talking about roots like this is so funny. You know, wind ensemble and concert band,
cool,
and Basie,
yeah,
and swing. And it's like, mm-hmm, you know, since I went to college, I started, you know, that's where I started as well. You know, I was lead alto player in the big band.
Word.
Or, you know, that was my roots too. And then college came, and, you know, I was into Bird and Train too, don't get me wrong. But then, yeah, when college came and... professor is like, oh, you haven't heard of Ornette? Oh, you got to deal with that. Have you studied Lee Konitz? Like, how about, like, you know, 50 other things? Or so it's just funny to get back to, not back to basics, but back to...
Basics.
Basiest, exactly. So, yeah, I wanted to play this. I mean, Count Basie Big Band is, like, kind of epitomizes swing, you know?
Of course.
But this Tad Dameron Big Band, I think it's like some of the most swinging music ever, and it's just like a totally unheard of group. Yeah, you'll hear it.
You'll hear it.
riff.
Oh shit. Yes. Yes.
Section has Bill Evans and Ron Carter and Philly Joe Jones, I'm pretty sure.
Wow. Yeah.
Clark Terry's in the trumpet section. Johnny Griffin. It's like the craziest band ever.
For sure. It's wild.
Did John Riley show you that, or?
I don't think so. I think Saltzman.
Saltzman?
Or maybe something else on that recording, and I listened to the whole record. But that is a killing record, and
yeah,
it's one of the few examples I know with Philly Joe, the drummer, playing with a big band.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's kind of cool to like see his interpretation of it, you know.
And the small group playing in between the...
It's so solid, ensemble.
It's so ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's very solid. Yeah, to have people in that band that are so adept at playing both big band and small group, it's like the perfect combo, yeah. You know, yeah. I wanted to ask you, so I'm really curious about your, like, your teaching experience, because you've had a lot of students, right? Like, mm-hmm. How many students have you taught, like, at most in a week?
Like, as a studio?
Yeah.
Probably like 15 or so.
Oh my god!
Kids in a studio, yeah.
Yeah, that's a lot of. So each, that's like an hour each, right?
No. These are like younger kids, so it usually was like a half hour, 45 minutes. I only do like a few hour long lessons for the older kids. I never recommend for the younger kids to do an hour.
Yeah. Okay, so I wanted to ask, what is like? Do you have any stories of like your best teaching moment? Like, something that, like, sticks out to you, teaching, because, you know, teaching a lot of lessons and stuff.
I think that's a good question, or a good thing for me to think about. I think for each kid, it's a little bit different, because everyone presents their own challenges, and I think that just because a kid is progressing well or doing really well doesn't necessarily give me more than... You know, a kid who started off really, really struggling with something, who's just starting to get his feet wet or her feet wet into, you know, what we're trying to learn. But for me, as like a new teacher who, you know, I haven't been teaching for all that many years as a private lesson instructor, definitely to figure out with sort of a definite feel of like, okay, yes, this is a really great way for me to teach this type of kid, you know, how to talk about slurring on the trombone. That was one that just came up very, very recently that was like, oh, I had this kid for maybe, this is our second or third year together, and we're finally starting to get into some more, like, he's starting to really get around the trombone. It's excellent. He sounds great. Now it's time to talk about slurring on the trombone, which you can imagine is pretty, it's like it's one of the challenges, right, of the instrument. What you actually have to do is...
His tongue really fast.
Tongue really light.
Right,
would be
right.
The idea. So, like, tongue so light that you don't hear it. So any jazz trombonist that you hear that's improvising, the guy that I always think of is Carl Fontana, who's, like, one of my big heroes, is, like, he's got this crazy light tongue where it sounds like he's playing so smoothly. Anything that you hear that's smooth on the trombone is actually not a trombone. It's just moving their slide from note to note. Though that happens sometimes, it's called a natural slur, where you'll actually get a break in the partial, in the harmonic series. And without tonguing at all, it'll just snap into that note. But most of the time, you have to use a really, really light tongue and try to match the sound of what a slur is. But you can't explain that to an 11-year-old. Oh. You can't say, oh yeah, just tongue really, really lightly.
So what do you say to him?
So what we finally got to was, you know, it was a progression of things, because it was something that I had to learn too. And I had to, like, not fake it till you make it type thing. But, like, you learn how to deal with it. You can't just say, okay, now play with a really, really light tongue as if you're slurring. That doesn't work on an 11-year-old. So we started with play with a really, really aggressive tongue. Like, play this super, super tongued. First, we needed to get to, like, what is the difference between these two things? Then it was like, good, play with as little tongue as you can. And then from there, it's funny, this kid was kind of like my little, like, a guinea pig experiment. From there, he started to really get the light tongue of it, but...
Find the extremes.
But then the coordination of actually matching your slide, the other side of slurring on the trombone is actually, when you use your tongue that lightly, is actually lining up the tongue with the exact position that you need to get it into, which means that you have to have a lot of speed. You know, if you're doing 16th notes, or in this case we were doing 8th notes, and you have to go from first out to fourth position, that's probably a good foot plus that you have to move in an 8th note span of time. Yeah. And so for a kid who's never really thought about that, it's like, okay, now he's really focused on his tongue. But we also have to talk about lining that tongue up with something. With, now you have to move your slide really fast. So the other side of slurring that we had to talk about was slide speed, which I thought, and I think it's working well for the young man, is working on moving your slide really fast, putting your slide in the position that you mean to when you mean to. Because he's starting to hear, do you hear we talk about goop? Right, the goop between the notes. Sometimes if you tongue a note before your slide gets there, if you're in third and a half position trying to get to fourth, you'll get that ta sound in there. And you're like, oh, do you hear the goop? And he's like, yep, there's the goop in there. It's like, we need to move our slide a little bit faster. That's how we're going to get there. And so he'll, you know, get away from focusing on the tongue for a second. He'll start to do that intuitively. And now he's starting, and we talk about how to use your wrist, right? And the way that you would talk to a drummer about their wrist or being loose.
Yeah.
But I would imagine you have to be pretty loose with it, otherwise you're going to hurt yourself.
Yeah, in the beginning, for sure, yeah.
Same thing with your slide. Like, you need to have a nice grip on the slide, but you need to have a really loose wrist, because to get there that fast, you need to snap to it.
Yeah,
we've been talking about snap to it. So you're actually kind of, a lot of trombonists talk about throwing the slide, which is like, I wouldn't say that to him, because then he'd just launch his slide across the room and break his horn and I'd get in trouble. But we talk about snap to it. Like, come on, man, snap to it. And he's like, you got it. And bang, first to fourth position, first to fifth position, first out to sixth. And he starts to snap to it. Then he starts to get his tongue involved with that. Then we start to get into the natural slurs, which are the exception to the rule. Like, we want to learn how to slur first, and then those natural slurs that occur are going to happen occasionally, like when we're switching partials, for example. That's how those natural slurs happen.
Mm.
So that's how we had to
deal with that.
Deal with that. But I guess so that's a really long form answer to your question. Is like, whenever I learn how to do something that I haven't thought about in a really long time and explain it to a kid, that I definitely get a lot of satisfaction out of that. Something like I haven't thought about how to slur. Like, I think about it in those really, really broad terms now of like, oh, I got to move my side faster. I got to lighten up my tongue. I got to do this. I got to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have so many years of practice behind it, the same way that anyone does spending that much time on their instrument.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a give and take for young students compared to older students. And when I say that, I mean young students, they can pick up stuff super easily, I feel, if they get it.
Yeah.
If they, like, understand it conceptually. For older students, I feel, I don't know exactly, like what the ratio is or anything, but, like, definitely it takes longer to get things committed to muscle memory.
Yeah.
But also you have the conceptual mind to, like, get there faster. So, like, I feel like studying now, I kind of have a better idea of what I need to do compared to when I was like 10 years old, you know? But also when I was 10, it was like learning a language is much easier when you're younger. It's kind of like the same thing, but it's like now conceptually when you're older, you're more mature. You have more of like a discipline with yourself to learn things. But, you know, it also is a little harder to learn as you get older.
Mm. And I think something that that's really, really important for the young kids, at least for elementary school, like beginning of middle school, even up to the end of middle school, is like really, really trying to foster having fun on, like, maybe right now at this very moment, teaching my student that I've been talking about how to slur.
Mm.
Yes, that's super important because that's where we are. But if he hates it, if he's not having a good time, by the time he gets to high school and he's ready to do that critical thinking and you know, he is ready to kind of hunker down and can really commit some good focus and a brilliant mind to what he's doing, you know, if he hates it by that time, he's just gonna quit. One thing that I did during the pandemic, because I had nothing else to do, because none of us did, was like sit with my students who I now had over Zoom, which was gonna make everything harder anyway. And I was like, what's your favorite song? Like, what song do you love? What song are you listening to right now? And they all gave me a couple of songs that I listened to, and I just wrote them for them. And I wrote them to whatever, I was like, okay, I know this guy is, he needs to work on this, he needs to work on his range, he needs to work on his low range, you know? And you just write a song that they love and work on something that they need to work on. That way they're working on something and they have no idea, because they're like, oh my God, this is my favorite song.
Like an arrangement? Like you wrote a trombone part to that song?
Yeah, like a really...
The melody.
A really silly example is like there's the coffin dance meme. I don't know if you guys know what that... I didn't.
I don't know that.
Yeah.
The four African guys carrying a coffin.
Like dancing, carrying the coffin. There's a song that goes along with it. And one of my students...
Wow.
It was like, you could tell, like, we're playing this one piece that's working on the stuff that he needs to work on. It's a Nisma piece, so it's not the most exciting thing. Mm. And so I was like, all right, we need to take a break. What's your favorite song? And he was like, I love the coffin dance meme song. And it's just like, it's just like 8 bars. It's just super easy.
Yeah.
But that's a lesson's worth of music right there, because it was challenging for him.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, his eyes lit up. He was really into it. He corrected me on a rhythm that I wrote. He was like, that's not the rhythm. This is the rhythm.
Ah.
And we worked with that. It was okay, well, how would you write that rhythm? It's different than the rhythm on the page. And you get him. And he's like, oh, that's an eighth note. That's an eighth note that needs to go there. It needs to be an F instead of a B flat, you know?
And the excitement is there to fuel that desire, you know?
And by the time he gets to high school, if he has those good positive experiences behind what he's done when he was 9 through 11, you know, he's going to be that much more inspired to actually put in the time and work when you know, he can focus on the what he might perceive as the drier repertoire, you know?
Yeah, I really do think there's a lot to that. And like, I was talking to my teacher John Riley actually at MSM about that. And he was saying, yeah, like, you have to just kind of go where you want to go, and you'll learn the best from doing that, because you're passionate and inspired by that kind of material, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, like, and that also helps musicians not become the cookie cutter outline that, like, that, like, a lot of schools have a reputation of making people, not MSM in particular, but allowing yourself to, like, go with your passion, you know, and,
yeah,
and
sure.
really what music inspires you.
It creates individuals.
It creates individuals, yeah. I wanted to ask you, do you have a guilty pleasure song?
Coffin Dance.
The Coffin Dance, you know.
Man, you can't make that up.
That's guilty, like, pleasure song. I No, I don't think so. I for a while, think that, like, I really compartmentalized too much. Like, definitely through, like, undergrad and going through that sort of, like, whole, like, sort of closed-in experience that you can go through in, like, if you go to the quote-unquote jazz school and you're learning how to improvise in that closed context, you can start to think of everything in that like, okay, everything has to have a meaning. Everything has to be educational.
I know what you mean.
Starts to take away a little bit of the fun of it,
yeah.
or sort of the enjoyment that you get out of music.
Yeah.
And so, like, I think for a little bit too long of a time, I started to compartmentalize jazz as, like, learning, as opposed to, like, I really love this. It started to become, like, I need to practice this, and it started to give me anxiety, like, listening to a Coltrane solo, instead of being like, oh my God, this is incredible, being like, I can't play that. Like, I can't do that.
Yeah.
I can't transcribe that. I'm not a good trombone player. And you start to all of a sudden, like, or at least I did, compartmentalize too much. And then that started to spread out to, like, those guilty pleasure songs that I had were, by contrast, like, not good.
Uh-huh.
You know, it was like... Because
they're not productive to listen to.
Not productive
guilty.
Is the great word.
Yeah.
I didn't...
It's fucked up.
I never really used that word, guilty pleasure.
Sure.
But because I do think that everything in music is, there's so many produced songs that people can trash on, like,
sure,
like, man, I've listened to Taylor Swift, some of her songs, the production level of those songs is, like, utmost quality.
I like,
you know?
Shake It Off. I do.
Yeah, it's
I
a
like
good
that
song.
Nothing
but,
guilty about it, huh?
Maybe that one's a little bit of a guilty,
yeah,
pleasure for me. But, like, that's personal. Because then also someone who really likes Shake It Off is gonna be like, why is that a guilty pleasure?
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to put anyone else's taste down either, because it's all valid.
Right,
I think
yeah.
the validity of it is what I try to, like. It's such a subjective thing, music, and, like,
it
definitely
is, yeah.
I think school more than anything, if you're not careful and you don't get out and get the right opinions, or at least a variety of opinions from a variety of people, and see that, like, oh, everyone's taste is valid. All of these incredible musicians have all of these different tastes, which means that I can have my own taste. You know, if you start to get it from only one source, whatever that source is, I used school as an example, but that was me because I didn't put myself out there enough and meet enough people. I stayed in my home base and didn't go anywhere.
Mm.
But it could be anywhere. You start to hone in on one thing, and then all of the other stuff starts to seem ancillary. It's like nothing else is as productive. As like, and sometimes it's not, depending on your goal, you know, but that's a self-set goal. If your goal is to, like, transcribe 6 bird solos, dope. That's dope. That's a great thing.
Yeah.
But, like, that's just your goal right now. It doesn't mean that, like, nothing that isn't bird is, like, unproductive and dumb. And that's definitely the mindset that I put myself in for probably too long and stressed myself out a lot.
You've been in a lot of different ensembles, though. I mean, you've had an experience that a lot of people don't have, you know, like, experience playing in a ska band or like
the world's after party, check us out.
Shout out.
We're on Spotify, Scarlet Knight's EP.
Oh, we should listen to that.
Oh, Lord.
Hey, you said check us out, man.
No,
we're going to get 3 more listens. I'm kidding.
Playing Sousaphone, you know, there's a lot of different experiences there.
Yeah, it's all, yeah.
Know? Yeah.
And it's all super, super valid. Like, all great stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I'd like to come back to this idea of productivity and work ethic as opposed to just like pure like bass joy, you know? Do you think you guys think it's, if you were to not ever like hunker down, sit down with the metronome and like work, if all you did with music was just play, you took out your horn or what, your piano, and you just put on your favorite music and you just played day after day and only did the things you enjoy, do you think you can still become world class, or does becoming world class necessitate at least some level of like, I don't want to do it, but I'm going to do it anyway?
I think in any field at all, music aside, you go anywhere and you have to commit yourself, because people who are world class in that field are doing the very same thing. I think that's an interesting question. I think, yeah, definitely. The right person. For me personally, if I don't sit down and commit, you know, some time to say like the Arbenz book and like really working on like the nuts and bolts of playing trombone and like really getting to the core of it. And this is just me personally. It's probably not going to come out in the playing that I want it to come out in as clearly. Like if I don't sit with the, and again, it's all just personal to me. You don't want to speak for anyone else, but like, if I don't sit down in the double tonguing section of the Arbenz book and practice it like a doodle tongue, or if I don't sit with, you know, my tuner and do long tones, then all of a sudden when I want to play along with Joe Henderson, I'm probably not going to play as in tune as I would as if I spent the half hour with the tuner. And maybe the half hour with the tuner wasn't like the highlight of my practice day.
Yeah.
But it definitely, I definitely think it helps. Like focusing hyper specific things. That's something that you can do as a product of being an older, more mature musician, is to sit down and actually have the focus. It's the difference between us and little kids that we're teaching. It's important to foster the happiness and the joy in just playing, because right now, just playing is going to do it for them.
Right, word.
That's going to make them better. But like right now, maybe today, like I got to work on my intonation because it's a little bit out of tune. And maybe sitting down with my favorite, you know, favorite J.J. Johnson record might not help my intonation today.
Yeah.
Which is just, again, just for me. But like I think you definitely need those moments of like, I don't really want to, but you know, today's the day. And also the consistency factor of it is, you know, you're working muscles.
Yeah.
At least as all of us, you know, brass players, you're working muscles, saxophone player you're working muscles. If you don't work a muscle, it atrophies.
Yeah, totally, of course.
And then all of a sudden, like, you know, if I don't practice doodle tonguing for 4 days, you know, it just bit by bit, and then a week or 2 weeks. I guess so.
Scary. You know, me, at least, you know,
you can always, I think the flip side is you can always get it back.
You can, yeah.
Definitely. But like, you know, if you want to be that world class, part of world class, I think, is the consistency.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think because I've been like super, had a bad relationship with my craft at some points because it felt like so much work and pressure to do. I think that's what we were talking about before, but yeah. If you tell yourself your goal is I want to become world class at this, you know, I want to be able to, I don't want to say compete, but be amongst, you know, the best of the best on this instrument, to really say something that has you know, world class things, then you have to just accept that this is not going to be play all the time. And
yeah, and I think a lot of that comes down to the approach of it and the self-talk. Like, I used to be a really, really angry practicer. Like, punching walls and shit. Like, bad stuff. Because I thought I had to be perfect 100% of the time, and then you crack a note, and you're like, God damn it. My parents are, I hope they're watching this. They remember me in the basement. I don't do it anymore. Practicing in the basement and just screaming, cursing myself out.
Wow.
Just angry, I think, and I don't think my goal has changed. You know, I still want to be one of the, I still want to be a world-class trombone player, but my approach to that and the self-talk that goes into it is like, yeah. It's not like, you know, if you don't do this, you will not be world-class. It's put in the time today. You know, you put in the time today. That's what makes you world-class. Put in your consistency, put in your time. It's okay. And if you put in the time and the consistency is there, you are going to improve. If you have the right approach, you're going to get better. And if you keep the self-talk away, which is probably the hardest thing to do, at least for me, you know, I think you can keep the goal. And then that, at least for me, the anger and the frustration came from what I was telling myself I needed to do to get there. Mm. As opposed to just cool it. Your goal's not going to change. My goal wasn't ever going to change. So we need to find a new approach.
Yeah. Well, thanks so much for sharing that. I mean, that's
Yeah, you're definitely not alone. I've definitely had experiences where I was like,
for sure,
smashing the crap out of a cymbal like excessively, like you know, like too, like,
I love it.
I love it, man. Maybe that's why you like Hella.
Very, I think very metal. Very, very metal.
You actually hate the drums. Sorry, I had to go there.
But there, yeah, there's definitely, you're not alone. And it's for really sure. A mindset, psychological thing.
Yeah.
It came to me, I don't know when it came to you, but it came to me, if I wouldn't touch the instrument enough for a couple of days, and then I would sit down and I would have like greater expectations for what I can do.
Yeah.
And then because of that, like kind of like atrophy you were talking about,
That's a really, really harsh word for that. It's kind of
extreme, yeah, but it's
that's
very extreme word. But not like still, atrophy. It's just like kind of like losing something, you know. But then you can get it back.
Yeah, right away.
But you know, yeah, right away. Like after a couple of hours, but still, it's like that first moment. It's like, what just happened?
It's like, it's like shit.
Yeah.
And if you think that you're supposed to be that person, right?
Yeah.
If you think you're supposed to be that person the second you pick up your instrument. You might have an issue, especially if you have a habit of negative self-talk.
Right.
And if you think, also if you keep comparing yourself to that person too, like, oh, like, they wouldn't do this if they sat down, you know?
Yeah.
They would be like, or whatever, you know? But like then you sit down. So like, that's another thing, like comparing yourself is healthy in some ways, but also not in others, you know?
When is it healthy?
That's a good point. Yeah, I mean, I guess comparing yourself, let's say you want to transcribe something and you want to try to match something similar,
you know? It's a very scientific approach to it.
Mm.
Yeah, but in other, yeah, no, it's true. In a lot of ways, it's not healthy because we're all unique.
Yeah, I mean, compare yourself in the context of practicing or like a very objective, like this sounds like this, this sounds like this. Okay, I can change this, make that sound like that. That type of thing. But anything regarding comparing your worth or your value as a person, which we always do, like this person's so much killing, like he's like a better human being.
Yeah.
Like that is, I mean, it's what we do all the time, if we're being honest with ourselves, but.
Yeah, totally.
And totally on social media, like this girl is prettier than me or this dude is buffer than me or whatever. It's like.
Yeah, or like, oh, he's shredding and this was definitely his first take.
Yeah. We always have those things, like, and they're not only better as than us as musicians, but they're just like better people, you know.
Right. That's the conclusion. Right. Is like they are better at the thing that is my dream, and therefore they are, just overall, like worth more than me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Fuck that.
That sucks. My therapist calls it compare and despair.
Huh.
And so you're like, you know, you compare and despair. You compare yourself to that person, and I guess it's a two-way street because you either think you're worse than them. And then you're like, fuck, nothing works, and I'm horrible. Or you think you're better than them for some reason,
right?
And your ego, just your ego is I mean, positive. The ego is both ways. I mean, that is when you're comparing and despairing. It is your ego either bringing you down or your ego lifting you higher than you need to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's an excellent point. I haven't thought about the ego boosts that come along with something that does well. Everybody talks about the negative comparisons. But the kind of inflation, that's actually not really healthy either.
No way. If you're constantly listening to people. I used to do it. So I you know, you listen to people around, you're like, you know, I if you're listening to people and thinking about how much worse you are, naturally, when you hear someone that you think you're better than, that is the thought that's going to come into your head.
Yeah.
And so you're constantly ranking yourself amongst the people that your peers, the people that are your age, amongst professionals who have been doing it for 20 plus years longer than you. Yeah. And that's a fucking problem if you think you're going to, you know, if you think you're going to match up to someone who's just got all the experience in the world, that's not the relationship there, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
That's like compare and despair.
Yeah, I love that. That's one of the things I love about studying with Jaleel Shah, who I'm studying with, is like, I mean, I can go see him play with Roy Haynes and he will also like eat dinner with you and like call you to see if you're okay, like the humility of it, like, okay, yeah, I am a badass certified, but I'm also your mentor and I care about your well-being, and like that relationship has been incredibly healthy for me. And also just moving to New York in general and, you know, running into, I don't know, someone like Wynton Marsalis on the subway, like that can happen, and he'll probably say hi, and you see them in the flesh. They're not this like idea in your head or, you know, pixels on a screen. You know, you actually see them and
making it more human.
Yeah,
that's so cool. Yeah, that's, I mean, that's an awesome thing that you have with your with Jaleel Shah. That you have that's such a human relationship there.
And from what I've heard from Marshall too, you know, Joe's told me that that relationship is a very inspiring one.
Yeah, he's you know, he just goes about his business in the way that he's one of the, you know, greatest trombone players on the planet. But he's just like, yep, I'm a trombone player, and then he plays, and you're like, fuck, you're not just a trombone player, but you know the way that, yeah, he talks in lessons, it's all very down to earth. It's just like, here's what we're going to talk about today. Mm-hmm. I think it's, yeah, same idea. It's showing by example. You know, you'll never ever hear him mention anything about like being one of the great trombone players on the planet ever. He's not sitting there like, you know, man, I didn't get to be who I am today because of, you know, sitting back and not practicing. Like that's crazy talk.
Yeah.
Like that never would even cross, I don't think it would cross his mind. And if it does, then he wouldn't say it, but it doesn't.
Right.
So like that's the attitude. You gotta have, like, not even ranking yourself probably in your rearview mirror even.
Yeah. The more you I feel like I come to analyze like top drummers or something, like so many people like rank drummers a lot, and yeah. I'm sure it's in other fields too. It's like, but the thing is, it's not really the I guess some musicians do that, but also as people that are like fans of musicians, they're like fans of the music a lot, like they like to rank like the best drummer or something, you know, or something.
Yeah, I mean, like, I guess that's just part of the nature of being, I think, in front of people. Because, like, they do that with athletes, too. Anything in the entertainment field, you want to rank. But I don't think athletes are themselves, at least, you know, I think maybe a lot of them do. That's probably a poor example. But, like, people will rank us, you know, as we start to, you know, rise in the world or whatever, you know, as long as we get, you know, more notoriety, is the people who get more notoriety, they get ranked.
And they get criticized more too.
Absolutely. You're in the spot, you gotta have the thick skin or whatever. Yeah. But like those people that are being ranked, I don't think the attitude is like, yeah, that is the, you know, let it go to your head.
No, yeah.
You gotta just like keep your head down and go about your,
even if athletes did have that attitude, I don't think in any field it would be healthy to have that, like, I'm better than this guy, so like I'll stay on the team, you know, I'll get drafted first or whatever.
I think it's that difference between like confidence and ego. I think on the field, like talking about NFL players, it's probably a little, if you think you're the baddest dude out there because your job is to hit someone as hard as possible, that probably extra ego boost is probably decent for you. You know, if you're like, I am the baddest and I'm going to hit you super, super hard. And also, at the end of a football game, there's a winner. You're supposed to rank. There's people come in first place. You win a championship. There's no championship. There's jazz competitions, but those are all bullshit anyway.
Yeah, yeah. I really hope that music never gets to that point. But, I mean, that's what we're doing, like, in Downbeat Magazine. We vote on our number one rising star on every instrument and the number one college jazz soloist.
Even some bands I know, they rank in, like, one school, they would rank, like, they would call it, like, varsity, junior varsity jazz band.
Well, like, I mean, are you talking about, like, have a top band and a lower level band?
Yeah, but even, like, using the sport terms.
Oh, my God, that's disgusting.
And JV.
I'm in the varsity band? Oh, wow.
You gotta make varsity.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Yeah, ranking is a super, probably super dangerous thing. That we gotta, everyone else is gonna do it for us, so we should probably just put it, like, I don't know, you know, is John Riley in the Downbeat poll ever? Like, is he ever ranked in the Downbeat poll?
I'm not sure. I don't read Downbeat.
Like, do you think he cares, even?
I don't think he cares.
Like, the people who make Downbeat care, because it's going to sell Downbeat Magazine to have the Downbeat poll in there, and people are going to say, oh, who are the top drummers?
That's the only time I open up, if I'm being honest.
Sure.
The awards.
The Downbeat Polls winner comes in, and I click on that link.
Yeah, you, see you the look at any other issue, any other month of the year.
And you're like, what the fuck? My favorite musician isn't even on this list. How is that possible?
Right, word.
That's just how little that stuff
matters. I mean, as much as I'm shitting on it right now, like, that is the reason that I only ever open it, so.
Good marketing tactic.
It's like a human.
They instinct. Got us.
They did. They got us.
They got us, and it's perfect, and they did great.
Yeah.
Great job, Downbeat. Please sponsor Brave Sound Productions.
That'd be dope, actually.
I want to play you another song.
Yeah.
And I'm not even going to introduce it at all. I just want to hear your first reaction.
Oh, what was the name of that Steely Dan tune?
Oh, that was Babylon Sisters.
Oh, of course, of course. I only heard it 50 times.
Shake it. Yeah. Alright, this is...
I love this song.
Oh, yeah.
I fucking know this song. This is a killer song.
How do you know the song? I'll play a little bit.
Youngblood is... Us these dudes in high school. I played this song in high school.
Oh, wow, okay.
I have this chart on PDF.
Summer, King's Dominion in Virginia, and they had this song as, like, one of the 8 songs that they would always play on through the park the whole summer.
Cool.
So, like, I was like, I really, like, got to know this track. Yeah.
I love all of Youngblood Brass Band stuff. Is all my favorite shit. Yeah. I love this band.
Yeah. Reminds me of, like, Trombone Shorty type of stuff too.
Sure. This stuff predates Trombone Shorty by a good decade and a half.
Oh my god.
Youngblood was around in the late 90s.
And you said they were all in high school when they were doing it?
No, I played this song in high school.
Oh, okay.
But these dudes are from, like, Wisconsin.
Oh, wow.
These are, like, a bunch of dudes from Wisconsin.
Yeah. Killing.
Killer players, all of them. And wait till you hear the tuba player. Have you heard this track before?
No.
Holy shit, wait till you hear the tuba player. His name is Nat McIntosh.
Nat McIntosh.
Fucking ridiculous.
So they're a really popular group, like, outside of jazz. Yeah. They're just, like, really
big in Europe. They tour around Europe a lot. I can tell because I always look for them in New York and they're never here. I'm very sad about it.
And they're still active.
Yeah. Yeah, they just released something in, like, 2017.
You hear that rip?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Woo! This is shit that makes you want to play Sousaphone.
Yeah, yeah.
If anything. Called Warrior Comes Out to Play. I forget which album it's on.
That's some crazy sousaphone.
Yeah, he balls to the wall.
Yeah.
This is a solo sousaphone piece called The Warrior Comes Out to Play.
With the guy you mentioned?
Yeah, Nat McIntosh. I'm so excited.
Multiphonics too.
Yeah, he's like the master.
You hear them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Just like randomly in the middle of these crazy jumps and lines.
Purchase that song on PDF on Youngblood Brass Band's website. Youngblood Brass Band, please sponsor us here at Brave Sound Productions.
Thanks.
You got it, yeah, man.
Wow.
That is quite the track.
Wow, I'm really excited for Saturday now, actually. Yeah.
Our tuba player is actually better than that.
Yeah.
Ben is...
I rank him as the number one.
Didn't we just talk about that?
Youngblood, Greg, Double Qtet.
Love it.
You wanna end with some talk about Saturday? What's going on?
Yeah.
So the concert is happening on this Saturday, October 24th, 2 p.m. There will be a link in the description where you can buy tickets on a name-your-own-price model. Who's in the band? Damian Pacheco on trumpet. I played with him.
You played with Damian?
Yeah, at Swing 46 a couple times with cool. This like Sinatra-type singer. Yeah, he's a great player. Nick DeMaria on trumpet. Trombones are Greg DeAngelis, yours truly, and Joe Giordano. And then remind me the names of the tuba and French horn player.
So our French horn player, her name is Constance Mulford, and she is she's excellent. Really, really looking forward to having her. And the tuba player is my friend from Rutgers, Ben Rivera.
Beautiful.
And then in the rhythm section is our guy Mike. Our bass player's name is Keenan Zach, and Keenan is from. He's from out east on Long Island, so he's closer to the Stony Brook University area out there.
Right.
And Sam Taus is going to be playing piano. Sam. So we have a...
Stacked band.
Stacked band, absolutely.
Nice.
Super, super excited to have everyone playing. This is going to be sick.
It's going
to
be sick.
We got five charts. The intention was to write everything very, very differently. Like, just have a ton of variety in there. I think it's something that we're accomplishing really, really well. As many improvisers as we could get in the band are in the band, so we have a ton of different soloists that are going to come through and absolutely, you know, wreck these tunes in the best way. Mm-hmm. Jazz wreck, so, like, good.
Not shipwreck, jazz wreck.
Jazz is, like, bad. People always ask me, like, is it bad? Like, you don't like them? I know. That's not what I meant.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So you were telling us before we started you're planning on recording this group as well at some point, or have you...
Yeah, this is definitely something that I would love to keep doing. I think it's good for me, just as it's super healthy. I like writing. I like the challenge of writing for this particular ensemble.
Yeah.
And I think it's a really cool idea for an eventual album. You know, once I go into the studio and actually do, maybe when COVID times are over and you know, school is done and,
yeah,
you know, all those things. I think that's down the line for sure.
Beautiful. I'm looking forward. All right.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
You have any closing segments, or you as well, if you have anything else you wanted to.
No, I just think thank you both for having me on here and considering me for doing your, having me on your live stream and having the band. I think it's going to be awesome. I'm super honored that you guys thought that, you know, it was worth your time. And I think very grateful to have you guys and your resources coming over to help us out with this. It's going to be cool.
I mean, you did the rehearsal a couple of months ago without the intention of having it like in a concert or anything, you know, before you knew about this live stream. And just, I was just like super impressed by you getting together so many musicians, having these arrangements out that you were working on, you know, great compositions. And I just thought it had to be documented in some sort of way.
Definitely, definitely appreciate that. That's, you know, right, yeah. Like you said, wasn't my intention. Makes me feel for big band writers.
Yeah, and that's for sure.
Taping it was the hardest part. Physically taping the parts together, I mean, not recording it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That sucked. I got several paper cuts.
Yeah. Been there.
Yeah.
All right. Do we have a 90-second round?
I didn't make one, but I can come up with one quickly.
We can riff it.
All right, let's do the final 90 seconds of this interview. This is where we just shoot questions at you. Hopefully you don't get a paper cut.
I have to rapid fire answer the questions too?
Yeah, you have to rapid fire answer the questions. Alright. This is 90 seconds. Favorite book?
The Three Body Problem.
Okay, I'll look it up later. 90 seconds.
Favorite movie?
Shawshank Redemption.
Oh, good call.
Alright, favorite song right now?
Lockdown, Anderson .Paak.
Oh, yeah, I gotta check out Anderson .Paak. Favorite, you do some.
Best player on the Mets?
Pete Alonso.
Nice.
No, I'm sorry, that was a dumb answer. Jacob DeGrom, the best pitcher on the planet.
Yeah, that's what Joe would say.
Jacob DeGrom, I'm sorry to Joe for fucking it up.
Favorite trombone company?
Wrath, yeah, please sponsor me.
Favorite poem?
I love Having a Coke with Having a Coke with You by, what's his name? That's the name of the poem.
Okay, we'll check it out.
Okay.
You have a favorite quote?
No. I think a lot of people said that one.
All right.
10 seconds. Favorite pastime besides trombone?
Baseball.
Okay. I think that's it.
All right. Thank you so much, Greg DeAngelis. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Have a great night, and we'll see you Saturday.
Saturday.
Saturday, 2 p.m. Eastern. Tickets.